we weren't ready to run a Hadoop cluster to get all those files from S3. So we thought, okay, we need to get a little bit smarter with this. And we also live by the philosophy of using the right tool for the right job. So we started thinking, researching, and we decided to go for an approach where all the data we had in S3 and also another DB, which for the sake of this meetup I won't mention, but I saw a documentary about subliminal messages, so voila, that's done. So yeah, data in Elasticsearch, easier to aggregate over the big chunk of data we have. And that allowed us to build tools or websites like these. So this is something that's publicly available that you can just visit. It's index.boring.com. And it's a full list of all the websites that get generated in our system. It gets, it's constantly refreshed with new reports. And it gives an aggregation over certain important SEO or digital marketing metrics of that list. So in this case, it's the full list. There are no filters used. But if you want it, you could say, okay, I want to see, or there is better, more visible. In the United States, give me a list of all the websites in RDB, obviously, that are using Google Analytics. And then you get the list mapped out over there. So that was already quite a big win for us. And we we had the system running on Elasticsearch quite quickly. And yeah, that spurred the idea of going further with this. Like, the road doesn't end by only aggregating data on top of the reports we create, but can we dig deeper? And one of the other ideas was more an idea that came from inside, namely our support team. They have their own tools to get information about all the users in our system, on how those users interact with us. They ask questions, they need help, so that all goes in that system. But although they can segment people by certain metrics, it doesn't give a clear overview on what's going on and how quickly we can help those people. So they provide an API, this tool, it's called Intercom, by the way. They provide an API, and so we build a system that extracts all the data from that API, dumps it into Elasticsearch, and then with Kibana, we build a dashboard on top of that to monitor on how our support team is doing. And as you can see on top, maybe it's not very readable for the people in the back, but so we map out per hour how many messages get sent. There are metrics over there on how long a customer has to wait before his question gets finally answered, gets solved. User waiting time based on some priorities we set. So in that same system, we also built, okay, it's a long-running client that's very loyal to us. So the priority on his list, on his question is much higher, things like that. So they all get mapped out in this system. And that helped us a lot in improving the way we interact with our customers. So that was a second project. A third project we did was on top of our accounting. So it's a SaaS tool we built, so people pay by credit card. The information gets handled by another third party we use, Recurly, but they don't provide any good data on how long people stay, retention, when they drop out. So that's also something we had to build ourselves. We extracted everything from their API, dump it in Elasticsearch, build another ready to use Kibana dashboard on top of that, and then we get stuff like that. So this is our third use case. And now what's in store for the next months is for our running our applications, we use Docker, no? has to be mentioned in every talk these days. We use Docker and we build that on top of Mesos. So Mesos, if you don't know, in a nutshell, it's basically a resource manager that sits on top of your full infrastructure and that allows you to just look at your servers as resource pools. You throw applications at it and Mesos will make sure that they get deployed on a server. You don't have to worry about that. So. But for data, that is sometimes a little bit difficult because you have data in flight and an application or, in this case, a database process can spawn wherever you want, so data needs to move along. So one of our next projects will be, and there are already efforts in the open source community to bring Elasticsearch to Mesos, so that will be our next step. And yeah, I'm very eager to tonight work with the big boards over there to see if we can get Mesos running on top of that so we can test. And that concludes my talk. Thank you.
Any questions for Nils?
Short Q&A.
Shoot. Anybody else has been using Elasticsearch for similar purposes? Either using SEO or intercom or help desk type of Banon screens? Nope. Well, you could. So, the next speaker is Kris Buytaert. I knew it. He's going to talk about the much more log-based approach of Elasticsearch. Yep. He's been doing this for a long time. Maybe a show of hands. How many people are going to Elastical? The group in this room? Oh, it's quite some fortunate lucky birds in here. So, Sandy is sitting on the front row here. She works for Data.be. We're hosting this meetup. And Kris is actually her husband. So this is, I guess, one of those couples where they can speak Elasticsearch before they go to sleep. No, you don't? That's a healthy sign, probably. Time, you know the same. So, Kris, the floor is yours. As soon as it wants to come on the screen, fix that.
This is the part where I test first, and then it works, and now it doesn't work.
It's a nice blue screen.
Thank you.
while we're waiting for the screen to come up, maybe another show of hands. Who's here for Fosdem over the next 2 days? So that's, wow, that's 90% of the audience.
It's Pre-Fosdem. Check your location.
Yeah.
I was using the other one.
Which other one?
You don't play.
What other one?
Yeah, no.
Try the other box.
Come on.
It's hard to crop calibrate. Where is it?
It's a presentation you're trying to do or run stuff.
What we can do is run your presentation on one of our
Somebody's making a lot of money with connectors. Huh? It's a great industry.
2015, we still haven't figured it out.
So now it doesn't fit anymore.
I suggest otherwise.
Otherwise, we swap.
Presentations and we swap.
And you come
take
afterwards.
Your B-stick.
You feel okay for that?
One more
time. Dan, so what we're going to do is we're going to swap the order of the presentations.
There it is.
Oh, you see, that's all you need. That's all you need. You need to swap and then it works.
There it was.
No, it is. It's
looks the same as before.
See, there it is.
Didn't sometimes you just have to. So, Kris, go ahead. Floor is yours.
I need 2 more seconds. Sorry.
While we're waiting for the 2 more seconds, who plans to go after the pizzas to do the toy playing next door, installing Elasticsearch on cluster? Just to have an idea of how many people will join Nils when he goes home to his office. 1, 2, 3, 4. So it's about, like, there's almost 1 hex for each of you, so that's going to be very cozy. Good. Kris?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
And now the mic doesn't work?
No, okay. Fine.
Cabling. You got to love it. So yeah, for who doesn't know me? Oh shit, I need to do this last.
You're notorious.
So yeah, I'm Kris Buytaert. I've been doing this open source thing for 2 decades now, I guess. I started my career back in the 90s as a software developer, doing stuff in all kind of weird languages. And then I ended up doing operations also. Somewhere along the line, I started co-organizing a conference called DevOps Days together with Patrick Dubois. That's somewhere 5 years ago already. My role in daytime is I'm the chief trolling and chief travel officer at Inuits.eu, which is one of the larger open source consultancy companies in this area. Well, I organize way too many conferences. I don't write that much anymore, but a lot of people know me from my blog, which is titled "Everything is a fucking DNS problem," which apparently this week was again the case. So I mentioned DevOps already a couple of times, and a lot of people ask me what DevOps is about, and I have to thank these two guys, Damon Edwards and John Willis, to come up with a really good definition for what DevOps is for a lot of people. They have a podcast called DevOps Cafe, and while John was at the very first DevOps Days in Ghent 5 years ago, and Damon organized the ones in Mountain View, they started talking to people, figuring out what is DevOps about for you. And for a lot of people, it comes down to 4 key things. It's about the culture of an organization. It's about how they automate the shit out of everything, how to do monitoring and measurement, and that's where Elasticsearch comes in, and how we share both a lot of the code we use and a lot of the experiences. And then Jane Kim came in about 2-3 years ago, and then he added the influence from the lean to that. And so now we have, rather than cams, we have clams. So people cannot say anymore that it's a cam. So DevOps and monitoring and measurement. If you've done Twitter long enough, then you know that somewhere in June 2011, John Vincent tweeted monitoring sucks. And he was kind of right. Still is kind of right. And in a way, that became a sub-movement of the DevOps movement. We even started doing a GitHub repository where we were listing all the tools related to monitoring that we didn't like and one we liked. And then in Rome in DevOps Days 2011, Ulf Manson gave a talk about his newfound love about monitoring. He figured out that the way he could use automation to make monitoring better, and that combined with a bunch of the new tools that were around, he really started loving monitoring again. So that was, to him and to a lot of people, the start of a new era. A new era with a lot of new open source tools that were allowing us to do monitoring a lot better. We helped a bit by organizing monitoring love hack sessions at our office. I think we did it like 2-3 years in a row, right after Fosdem. And then Monitorama came along. And during those sessions, and people came up with, what do we really want when we talk about monitoring? And it all boils down back to the basic Unix philosophy. We want small tools that are all good at their job, but which we can easily tie together. And we want small components that can do collection of data, collection of metrics, transport them and modify them, and store them somewhere, other tools, analyze them. And then we also need tools that do where you can alert based on topics and where you can actually visualize them. And what happens is people then come up with this kind of architecture. The blue part is collection. This part is transformation and throwing it somewhere. This is more visualizing it and storing it sometimes. And well, that's a lot of tools. So initially, a lot of people were focusing on just, well, let's look at a service and let's check that service and figure out what's going on. And that was monitoring. And then a couple of people figure out, now we have all these log files on our system. And most people just ignore them. Most people don't even look at them. Log files contain so many relevant things, like Java stack traces, like errors from PHP applications, like your system actually telling you, hey, there's something wrong here. And people only look at those files when something is wrong. And even then they forget about logging. So people started thinking about, well, we should do something with logging. We have standard syslog, we have rsyslog, we have syslogng, the Java guys use log4j, and then there were a couple of tools popping up like Greylog and Elsa from the Bellabit guys, and then one of the most popular ones, which we're going to talk today more, is the Elasticsearch Logstash Kibana stack, which what we started calling just Logstash like ages ago. So what is this? Well, to me, it's a tool I've been using for somebody look at GitHub when I started writing the puppet module for it, because I don't remember. Back when it was really a really horrible Java thingy, that's what people said, because they didn't understand it was JRuby. And back when it was really difficult to deploy. But it was fast when you knew how to work with it. And it gave us pretty much the three components. It had a shipper which you could use. It had an indexer. And it had a really ugly web interface. Be prepared, there's a picture of the initial web interface coming up. The good part about it, however, is there's a lot of plugins on this. I know that I've given this talk, well, this slide, I've used it a couple of times, and each time, not today, I reused the slide. I need to expand and shrink the font size because the list was growing and growing and growing. And it now has stuff going from Drupal database logs to just simple pipes. It gets stuff from Redis, it gets stuff from everywhere. And if you have an idea of an application, probably there is already a plugin. Probably there's already a part where you can use Logstash to collect your data, to collect your logs, and then do something with it. So that's easy. Typically, a lot of people still take rsyslog, and they use it through rsyslog input. You can use dedicated shippers. You can go direct, put stuff directly into Logstash, or write your logs directly in a JSON format and put it into Redis and do that. Or use whatever you want. So now you have something which collects your data and something which ships your data. And you already have a lot of different tools to build together. And then the next thing you need to do is do something with that data. So there's filters. A couple of filters are rock. Next slide is going to be about that. You can modify a string. You can modify a log entry, like make it all lowercase. You can say, this one I really don't care about, so just drop this one. Or you can also, depending on what you find inside the log file, add a tag to it. And based on those tags, you can do more and more. Now, grok, who knows grok? Those people use Logstash. Grok is pretty simple. Who's been using grep? Who likes grep? Christoph, you're too old. You're a Perl 6 guy? You're a Perl 6 guy? So, the problem with grep is that writing a regular expression, well, that's not something people like to do a lot. And there's so much standard stuff in there. There's IP addresses, there's log levels, there's host names, and we all know that. And grok kind of solves that. So this is a pattern which you can use to take an Nginx log file, and it actually splits it into relevant parts. And that makes it can also store it in Elasticsearch in a relevant way. And, well, we filtered it, we split it in the relevant parts, and now we can actually search much faster. And we have a tag there, well, it's grok, and we have those fields. So now we've got it parsed, we got it shipped, we got it collected, shipped, parsed, and stored in a, well, most people actually don't know anybody who does not store this Logstash data in Elasticsearch. So we store our data. And then there's plenty of other outputs. Based on action, you might want some email to be sent, or you want to have an alert being triggered, or you want to aggregate metrics on top of that. Or maybe do metrics on top of that. But the first thing that Jordan did was, you'll hear me talk about Jordan more, is build this. Who remembers this? Two people. Yeah. This was the very first Logstash web front end. And then Kibana came along. And it started looking better. I don't even remember the order. Was it first the PHP version, then the Ruby? No, it was first PHP version, then the Ruby version. And then it went completely client-side. The Ruby version was really one we didn't like that much, but now we have dashboards that look like this. And this is actually a production dashboard. And we come to the point where developers actually start building their own dashboards based on metrics they care about. So this is standard Apache log. Getting data out of a web application, where are people coming from? And the other one is actually a Windows application shipping real errors when there's user errors parsing. And it's the same tool now being used by both the application developers and the ops guys running that platform. So part of the exercise when you're trying to achieve a more DevOps kind of organization is use the same tools. And Logstash is one of those tools where you actually get people to use the same tool. They might have different use cases for it, but it's the same platform, and they learn from it again. So, what do we learn from this? We learn how applications behave. We learn how trends are happening. And a lot of people use this kind of dashboard to actually get metric data. But not everybody wants to keep data for years and years. Well, yeah, disk space is cheap, but there's no use in actually paying for the Amazon S3 to store a lot of data on there if you don't really use it, if you don't care about which user was logged on 2 years ago, but you do care about the number of users that were logged on. What you could do is actually send statistics via StatsD to Graphite and build graphs on top of the data, but don't keep the data anymore. And a lot of people are doing that. So you keep your Elasticsearch platform clean, and you send those metrics to Graphite. Who knows Graphite? Okay, then can I quickly go over this one? Graphite is also one of these awesome new generation monitoring tools. It's as easy as sending a string with some value and a timestamp to port 2003 of Graphite setup. And that is going to give you easy metrics, scalable metrics, where anything you can think of is a metric. So remember this slide? These are log files. These could be inputs for Logstash. If you're running Puppet or something or other configuration management tools, these reports can also go in there. But the interesting part then becomes this, like getting your logs and getting your metrics out of your data store, because you don't care about the data anymore. Why am I mentioning this? Graphite is one of those tools that loops back into Elasticsearch. It has a bunch of interesting friends to collect metrics, but its dashboards, and the most popular one being today Grafana, actually stores, it's almost looking like Kibana. It stores its dashboards in Elasticsearch. So you're using this again. I actually thought that I added one line here, and that's the whole stack from the guys over at Etsy. If you take Graphite, there's a lot of metrics in there. There's a lot of data in there which you can actually start building anomaly patterns from. And they've built a whole tool chain which is allowing you to do pattern analytics on top of the metrics you built. Guess what they're using in the back? Nobody? Elasticsearch, obviously. And that should have been on the slide, or it just fell off. So we've collected metrics, we've shipped metrics and alerts, we've been storing them, we've been visualizing them, we've been doing data analytics on top of them. What didn't we do yet?
Display them.
Wow. This is displaying them. That's displaying them.
Events.
We didn't alert on them yet. So here we go. A lot of people still use tools like Ikinga, Nigel's Fork, or Sensu, or things, and they use that to alert to their platforms. So one of the default outputs in Logstash is Nigel's outputs, where you say, well, this message got in, and it's a critical one, or it's an alert one, and, well, that's an issue on that platform. This is actually a track and trace application where a couple of the applications needed to have alerts based on some errors. And they're being sent to the Agile server, and when that alert happens, when the application fails, people are being paged. So now we pretty much covered all of the things you want to see when you're doing monitoring. And Elasticsearch plays a large role into all of that. I was told to keep it short, but if you run to this guy, buy him a beer. If he has time. I've said a lot about DevOps, I've said a lot about monitoring and using tools, but if you are talking about DevOps, remember it's not about the tools, it's about people working together, and it's about learning from each other and learning from the platform. And that was probably the short summary I want to give you guys about monitoring with Elasticsearch.
As promised, we're moving up the technical level as we continue this evening.
This wasn't technical.
No, well, the questions can be very technical now, because I know you'll stand them. So go ahead, shoot. In the back. I'll repeat the question so that the people on the other side of the webcam can hear them too. Go ahead.
Sorry?
Somebody wants to take Jordan's picture to serve.
Oh.
Everybody needs to buy him a beer. Another question.
Oh, really? I mean, for once, it's not titled Packaging Sucks.
She has a question.
And don't buy him a beer just for Logstash. Also do it for FPM. and a bunch of others. Way too much others, actually.
Shay, go ahead and ask your question.
You've tried, like you've been from the start in terms of Kibana and Logstash Web. What do you think about Kibana 4? Have you tried it?
No, not yet.
Okay.
Sorry.
Other questions? Yeah. Go ahead.
Do you do any alerting based on Elasticsearch queries? Because the sample we have is, it seems like a great way to build your main models. So, for example, instead of one alert query, then do you have like, okay, there is a query that sees that there's tons of errors?
So, so the question was if we alert. Now, can you repeat the question?
No, I forgot. The mic. Okay, so the sample on screen here is probably a good way to either fill your NIDOS with alerts or your email with alerts. And while what you possibly want is, okay, there's in my Elasticsearch there's tons of errors right now, so send one alert with a summary, for example.
Okay, so there's a couple of things which we do. This is a stack where this is an alert where we know that it's going to happen like once or twice a week, maybe. So that for us is a relevant alert. Then there's other setups where I actually count the number of instances, send them to StatsD, send them to Graphite, and alert them the number of alerts or the number of lines I get them based on top of that. But if you indeed get a lot of issues with that, you want to have another tool in between. Like Flapjack, that actually aggregates those and make sure you don't get too much mail. But I actually understood the first part is, do you also alert on what Elasticsearch does? And the question there is yes. I can show you my inbox.
Another question. Mike is in the audience, so I'll pass it on. No more? Maybe tell which countries you're currently working in, so people from those countries can see if they want to.
There. Got currently offices in the Czech Republic, Ukraine, the Netherlands, and Belgium. That's it for now.
Okay.
Was that what you wanted to?
Yes. And where do you travel to work?
Mostly Belgium, Amsterdam, and Stockholm.
So, people from those locations, feel free to hook up and when one is traveling to your part of the world.
Yeah, if I'm around there, I usually am at meetups or stuff. So.
Okay, good. Thanks a lot, Kris.
The next presentation is the first for our meetup because we're going to do hardware. And so far, all the Elasticsearch meetups we've done are all very software focused. And Daan, who is the guy, the tall guy standing up there, preparing his cabling. And then there's William sitting in the corner with his glasses. They're the co-founders of BigBoards, which is a Belgium-based startup. If you're a startup, everybody tells you don't do hardware. It's extremely hard to succeed. You have very long lead times before you get your product out. And by the time you get it out, it's being disrupted by Samsung or Apple, who have more resources to get the latest processor, the memory, and so on. But despite everybody telling them don't do it, they were very stubborn and they just did it. And if you look on the right side of the room for all of you, you can see what they've been building. I won't give away the surprise what's behind the blinking LEDs, but it's quite impressive, and it runs Elasticsearch. So I hope that after this presentation, the ones of you who manage a large budget and want to please their developers, they probably want to place an order. And I hear that you do volume discounts this evening, right? So. I would say, Daan, the floor is yours.
Yeah. That's not the right one.
While we're waiting for the screen, I'll fill up some time. So typically what they develop is very, very useful for data scientists who have a tough time getting their large data sets in and out of data centers, where they still have to pay Amazon and others for the whole bandwidth in and out. And now you can play around with large data sets on your private clusters on your desk you can pull a node and see what happens without having to destroy your virtual machine or your cluster or whatever you want to test in the live environment. So those are two very common use cases that BigBoards is intended for, to have people play around from their desk with a low energy solution. And I'm going to stop giving away all your secrets. Dan, it's yours.
Hello, everyone. My name is Dan, as mentioned by Tom, and I'm a geek, and I'm pretty proud of that. And today I would like to introduce my pet or our pet project. And I want to give you a sneak preview on basically what the next version is going to be for us. But before I do that, I would like to introduce how BigBoards actually came to be. Because our background is a big data background. So we are big data geeks. So we are geeks and we love data. Which means that at some point we had our software pet project, which we called AppMine. It was for analyzing large amounts of source code. We downloaded the whole Maven repository, we indexed it, put it in HBase and afterwards in Elasticsearch, and allowed people to query on it. But for doing that, we needed storage. There are quite some projects in Maven, and there are some people who find it very funny to put a 100 megabyte jar file into their project, which means that if you need to index it, it takes some time. So we knew about software. We started working with software, a whole long time ago. So we thought it was pretty straight road. We started experimenting with it, and in the end, we would have a working system and all as well. Well, it wasn't, because the road actually looked a bit like this. It was really hard to experiment with these new technologies, especially because of their distributed aspects. What happens if one of your nodes has a different time or has an offset or something like that? What happens if a node becomes unavailable, if you have network partitioning, split brain situations and stuff like that? So we needed a way to experiment with it. And to do that, we turned to hardware. And the first thing that we did was go to the hardware vendor around the block, and we ordered our first cluster and put it in our basement. We spent like a month, maybe, configuring everything, setting everything up. Back then, big data was very much romanticized. I don't even know if that's the correct word, but you get what I mean. It was really, really, really hard to get it up and running and to get it all working together. So in the end of the month, I got a very angry wife because I was spending too much time on my technology. And again, the electricity bill came in, which, if you're running a few nodes, isn't that good. Well, it's quite high, actually. So we need to figure something out. And Wim and I, we started discussing. And while we were discussing, we were looking at our phones and saying, this would be cool. Today, there was even a quad-core CPU in there. There's 3 gigs of memory. OK, it's not much, but it will give us enough power to actually experiment with it. So who of you knows Raspberry Pi? Who of you uses Raspberry Pi? Who of you uses it in production? Good thing, because it's unusable. It's, we figured it out the hard way. So we started building our first cluster, which looked a bit like this one, for running Hadoop on top, which isn't a good idea. 512 megabytes of memory is just too low to do anything useful with it, even for learning purposes. So we started looking around at different options, and we need something that could hold a hard disk. And in the end, we ended up with these boards, which are basically the boards that we're still using today, although there are slight iterations on the hardware we're using. So this is basically the device that we're using right now. And for us, it's helpful to understand what big data and what distributed technologies are all about. So again, if you're looking at Elasticsearch where you have sharding and replicating, what happens in different situations? You need to know that you want to know what's happening there. But at the same time, you might be more interested in working with the high-level concepts. Putting up Elasticsearch or Kibana or using Shield, which has been released a few days ago. So that would be interesting to just start playing with it. And that's why we built some kind of software layer on top, to make it easy for you guys to actually work with this technology. Because in the end, it matters that you actually can generate some value out of it, whether it is through learning, or just by implementing a software solution or any kind of solution. So when we started, there was nothing. Well, there was something, there was an idea that both of us had. But we needed to study a lot. It was a very, very, very lean learning curve. It was very difficult to get into these technologies, understand what was going on, how you could recover from split brain situations and stuff like that. And then I'm not even mentioning all the architectures and the fuzz that came around the whole concept of what big data actually is. Moreover, we wanted an environment where we could experiment. So we didn't want one big cluster where everyone is working on and someone does something wrong and has to be shot. We wanted an environment where you can actually do something wrong and make mistakes without infecting the whole team. So yeah, there's not a single presentation where you don't have mentioned Docker. Oh yeah, yeah. But you have a very nice sticker on it somewhere.
Nope.
No? Okay, my bad. Anyway, we migrated to Docker recently. We start with LXC, which is basically a component underneath Docker. Also a component underneath Mesos. But we moved to Docker to make it easier for people to create the software tins, which we call them. And these tins are basically reusable apps, reusable stacks that you can install on top. Elasticsearch is one of them. Elasticsearch with Marvel is another one. And Elasticsearch with Shield is another one. But you also have Hadoop, you also have Storm, you also have all the other usual suspects inside the big data world or inside the distributed world. So that makes it easy to work and learn about these new technologies. We also use something called Surf. Has anyone heard of Surf? Anyone heard of Vagrant? Okay, it's the same guys. So it's HashiCorp who is basically doing the same thing. They also release console. We use Surf, for example, to have the hexes interlinked to each other to make it possible to have them communicate and form a bigger cluster. So this is one of the clusters that we hooked six hexes together, and then you get something like this. And yes, you can have them in different colors. And yes, you can have them in pink as well. Although, yeah, that one, every hex gets its own name. The pink one is called Pinkie Pie. We don't choose the names. Yeah, we don't choose the names, but yeah. So in the end, what's important for us, we want to help people to understand what these new technologies actually can do and learn about these technologies and learn about the insights of the technologies at acceptable prices, at acceptable ways of doing this. You don't want to spend hours and days and weeks even figuring out how you actually should be doing it. You want to do it right from the start or be guided towards a working solution. So, as you can see, this is a presentation that we used. Pretty smart. But let me show you what I've been talking about. So this is Wintermute. It's basically the white one. So the spider, that's the beauty of 3D printing. You can basically print anything. That's Alice. You have Infinite. It's the orange one. The white one is called Dexter. And the other one is called Wintermute, and the one totally in front is actually a prototype, which is using Intel Intel architecture, while the other ones are using ARM. Another thing, the reason why we use ARM is that it's very, that's not going to work, it's very energy efficient. So a hex, when it's running at full power, well, while we're doing a TerraSort, for example, in Hadoop, it was only consuming like 48 watts. Compared to a similar cluster, it will consume a lot more. Hence the angry wife. Don't want to get there again. So this is Dexter, and this is Wintermute. So right now, both of them have something installed. For the sake of explaining, I'm going to remove one of the tins from one of them. Okay, so I told you about the app store that we're building. Most importantly, we want to have a clean environment that you can return to every time again. That's the reason why we use Docker, so you can just remove your container and start all over again. So over here, you see your nodes, so six nodes in this case. You see internal IP addresses and everything else. But now you need to install a component on top of it, a tint on top of it. And you have several of these tints available. This is not a library that's been updated continuously. It's more a library that you can add your own projects to. So if you create a tint, it's quite easy to create one yourself. You can basically hook up your Bitbucket project. So yes, on Bitbucket right now, we're integrating GitHub as we speak. Well, not as we speak, but you know what I mean. And you can create your own tints and you can install them from here. So right now, on this specific one, we have installed Elasticsearch with Marvel. So why with Marvel? We have a plain Elasticsearch where we like to play with, because we like to keep it as small as possible since we only have 2 gigs of memory on each single node. In this case, Elasticsearch, you can go back to, you can see that is being installed, and you can go to different user interfaces. In this case, Kibana, and I will continue the free trial. and otherwise, Elasticsearch Gov, where you can play a bit with your cluster and do stuff. So it makes it easy to work with your cluster. That's the whole point. You can also drop to a shell if there's something that you want to do. By clicking these, you get a shell and you can start doing whatever you want. I mean, a bit of a silly example. We are in the process of creating new tints all the time. We created one for Elasticsearch Shield, so if you want to try and play with it, you can just click it over here and we'll be installing onto your Hex and you will have it available. So that's basically the thing that I wanted to explain to you guys. The thing that I want to do is, then I have to see how I can figure out the IP address of. So underneath, that's something that you might find interesting. We're using Ansible. So everything is being done by Ansible, as you can see. Also, the whole management of the containers, that's something that we do for you guys. But it doesn't mean that you have to do everything yourself. You don't have to write Ansible. You just describe how your container or what should be running inside, and we will take it, from there and install it from there. Question maybe on this? Okay. So this is an empty one. This is a spider. Let's take Elasticsearch for example. So all these things are being converted into Ansible scripts and being run on the Hex, which is quite handy if you have to manage more than one server. So right now, this is going to take a while. I'm not going to fully show it to you because, it has to download the containers, it has to install everything. But what's basically happening is it will make a connection to the Docker Hub. All the tins are open source right now, so you can just contribute your own or do whatever you want with it. It will connect to the Docker Hub, we'll get the Docker image, and then we'll start the various daemons that it needs to actually give you an environment that you can play with. Of course, we are still working on a lot of these things. This is just a preview of what it's coming right now. Previously, it was more or less a user, well, command line tool that you were playing with. So we're very open to what people actually think of this. We have had a lot of feedback from people who say, this is rubbish. Do use Amazon. Probably that guy had shares there, because, well, we don't have that much money to play with it. So we really want to know what you guys think of it. Is it a good idea to do this? Could this help you or not? Or do you say, no, I'm not interested in something like this. I'd rather do it my own. So if you have any feedback for us, please do communicate. So that was it. Right now it has been installed. If I go here, Elasticsearch copy, and I have my cluster up and running. That's it. So I would like to ask you, is this something that can help you with the things that you're doing from day to day?
Quite.
What's the price?
$1 million question. I knew you were giving up.
Indeed. So we have two price settings. And before I go into more detail, we have two price settings. One for personal use, which is €1,750, and one for companies, which is €3,500. But right now, as a very small startup from Belgium, we are looking for people who want to communicate about these things. And we're searching for people who want to contribute and help us with doing this. So we're very much open in discussing the price to a certain limit, of course.
Not that desperate. they still have to buy the hardware in there.
The main thing is that it's very hard to do hardware, as mentioned earlier. Right now we have to 3D print everything, which means that you can't just buy this in all bulks, so it will cost you a lot of money. So that's why we're doing it as lean as possible. That's the price.
Go ahead. Other question.
First of all, it's really useful for people that want
to learn or try at at home or this. Are you thinking about have teams that's not only focused on data, like for example a load balancer, someone that want to try between server or other tests, maybe for education or?
Yeah, of course. One of the things that I'm playing with a lot these days is console. And console might be very interesting as well to play with and to see what actually happens underneath the whole swim protocol and the Dusser protocol. How it actually works. That's the thing that we want to bring forward. That's the thing that we want people to experiment with to give feedback as well. So indeed, you can install whatever you want. I mean, you have 6 nodes. You have 1 terabyte of disk space on each node. So you have 6 terabytes. You have 2 gigs of memory on each node. And that's only going to become better and better. I mean, the reason why it's only 2 gigs is because, well, basically you can't get anything higher than that unless you're called Samsung or Intel. And that makes it, that makes an ideal platform from our point of view for experimenting and actually working. Anyone else?
Okay. Yeah, I have kind of feedback and kind of question. Mm-hmm. So, as he already mentioned, I imagine it pretty nice for playing around, for like, never worked with ELK before and want to try it out. But the question is, I try to think about use case in production, where I would like to use it or where I could use it, and I can hardly think of any, because it's like, if in production there are already all the servers, there's already a DevOps team, there are VMs running and everything. So what are your plans for, or how do you think people want, or how do you want to get people to use it in production, besides just for trying, because for trying, I guess the amount of these things they buy won't be that much, because then, okay, you have one for the department to play around with, and that's it.
Indeed. There are two things that we see in the long term. Two actually problems that we see right now. First of all, if you go to a data center and you have to put servers inside there, you have to pay for the amount of power that it consumes. So by reducing that, you can actually put more processing power in smaller footprint and get higher higher processing amounts and higher throughput. That's from a big data side of view point of view. Because there you have more nodes, so you have more, you have spread your risk more, there are a few benefits there. From the software point of view, I've been working on a few projects here in Belgium where we had a team of 5 or 10 people working on one big cluster. And the problem was that if someone did do something wrong, we lost like a lot of time and a lot of money on just waiting for the system to be back up.
Maybe a show of hands, who's experienced this in his or her company? You've lost a cluster. Mm-hmm. So that's 6 hands that went up. What would be the cost that you have when you encounter this? If you have to put them on in time and means, like maybe, yeah, Nils, go ahead.
Yeah, so a use case I see for us.
Thank you.
So, I mentioned Mesos earlier, and we have clusters production test on AWS. But I see this as a very good example, because now, even in development, we want to connect to test environments which are in AWS in US through VPNs. So it's very slow. So having something on-premise that we can install Mesos on and just push our application containers to and connect from within our walls would, for us, be a good use case.
Yeah, we do get some feedback as well from people saying, yeah, we are not allowed to use AWS to do anything. So we need to find a different way of working. There is certainly something to say there on how you can use it for development purposes, certainly.
Can I also step in just a moment?
There's, so I wanted to add that indeed it's kind of our first take to it was that to be a productivity tool for a developer who wants to learn or do development on his own. But then within a team, when you share a cluster, you have the difficulties of things happening or unavailability of the cluster. When you have a personal device, it's easier and more productive. The next step we also envision is that we actually build prototypes in proof of concept stages for customers, and we deliver them on the Hex to them as part of the project. That's something we do as well. And in some instances, data is sensitive and the data cannot leave the building. What we also try to do is to put a Hex in there within the company, push data on there, pre-process it, and only ship the aggregate data out to a centralized environment. So the sensitive, personalized, privacy-sensitive data remains on site. So that's another thing. And then we have we've talked to the guys of Scalable, which is a kind of a Dropbox, but on your own servers, which gets interesting because you can build your own file server that's remotely accessible across the internet, but it's still in your basement or at home. So that's a nice approach. So that's something totally different.
More questions?
Yeah, okay, maybe one before we go for that one. Who's had this privacy issue that we were just referring to, that your company or the company you work for has data that you're not allowed to like push to Amazon to play around with because there's a lot of stuff in there that they want to expose? So that's like 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 hands.
So you have a use case there.
Hi. So as a tool for experimenting with distributed applications, how easy is it to like introduce certain classes of errors, like a slow network or a split between certain nodes and all those interesting things that go wrong in production?
Yeah. Well, you have full control. So that means that you basically
can do whatever you want. Does anyone know Chaos Monkey from the Netflix guys? Mm-hmm. So that's one thing that we're looking at as well, to, well, basically try things out and try to kill your cluster and see what happens. But of course, yeah, from the experimenting point of view, there are some things that we are going to build in that that will allow you to actually simulate these problems, like a slow network, for example. But even creating split brain situations on your hex, it's already pretty easy to do so. So it's quite nice to see what actually happens to different technologies, and quite funny as well.
Flex some cables. Sorry? You can walk there and just
We have some guys who are doing sales with these things, just to explain big data concepts and distributed concepts, and they basically take the whole thing and say, look, this is a big data cluster, it's magic. And then they show you the interface and they start pulling cables out just to show what actually happens. With Hadoop and AGFS, it's really fun to do because you see everything recovering. But you can also prove your point with doing something like that, especially to a customer. And selling software is in that way more difficult because you don't have anything in your hands. If you put a hex in their hands, they can actually, I'm not going to say they can feel the data, but they can feel the data. So that's the nice thing about it. People are playing with and put in their hands. You don't need to explain a lot to let them know that this is actually a combination of different computers all working together to solve your problem. Then they feel very special. So that actually helps as well.
More questions? We have some time left, so there's one up front.
So suppose I want to install a distributed application that isn't still or isn't in the open source yet. Mm-hmm. Let's take Mesos as a random example. If it's not as a tint or nothing available by mm-hmm. default, what steps does it require to install it?
Well, allow me to show you one of the tints. This Elasticsearch shield. So we wanted to make it as easy as possible. Previously, you had to write your own Ansible scripts, which was a bit tedious to do. So right now, the thing that you need to do is have a Docker instance to get started with, where you have the software and everything on. But we already provide Docker instances for ARM. With Elasticsearch, and there are enough Docker instances out there for non-ARM or Intel platforms. So the next thing that you need to do is basically create a description of what your tint actually is. So looking at this, this is all there is to it. So you just describe which the views are, which you will show in your management console. You will describe which containers you have, which the image that is being used, the command that's being run inside the image, which ports are being exposed, and where the configuration directory actually is. And then you can say, I create a new group, ES nodes, and all my ES nodes, these containers are running. So this is quite an easy way to explain what you want to have running where. We do the same thing with Hadoop. Of course, you will have more, I can show you that as well. That's the thing if you try things on your own.
Yeah.
So over here you have several containers. So you have a name node, you have a data node, you have a resource manager, you have a node manager, and then you say, yeah, I want to have on my master node, there's one node that you can claim as being a master, I want to install the name node and the resource manager, and on all other ones, I want to install a data node and a node manager. And then you have your big data cluster up and running. So for us, it's about making it easy for people to write these tints. Now, I may give the impression that the TINs are all about the stacks and the software that you're running, but we're actually providing three types of TINs. One is a stack TIN, like you're seeing over here. The other one is data TINs, so you can share your data sets around. You want to process Wikipedia, then you have a data set Wikipedia. You can load it immediately into Elasticsearch and start playing with it. And the last one is what we call educational TINs, where we will basically, if you go to the user interface, you will get some sort of split view. On one side, you will get an explanation on a tutorial or an how-to or your learning resource. And on the other side, you will get a shell where you can actually try things out and see how it behaves and see how it works. So those are the three things that, you know, the three TIN types that we're focusing on right now, just to make it, to make sure that, that people are willing to learn about these things. Because right now, it's from a, especially big data point of view, and even a distributed point of view, it's very hard to find people who really understand this, who really know what they're doing and are willing to dive into this.
More questions? You just talked about the education part, so let me kick in there. I know there's people from Found here who are doing Elasticsearch trainings. Maybe, is that, you want to say something about this? Would this be useful for you? I'm looking where that person is in the public now. Somebody's been putting folders in the back, so there must be somebody here. Let me see. Yeah, you're here, right?
You escaped the building, right?
We don't do Elasticsearch training. We do Elasticsearch as a service. So a lot of our marketing is essentially to help or educate people. So there are some flyers in the back there and some stickers. The leaflets have a few samples of articles where you can read about Elasticsearch in production and lots of other things.
Okay, great. Thanks. There were more questions in the back, so feel free to pass it on. And there's somebody who's working for Elasticsearch who's getting the camera now, so sorry, the microphone.
I think you say it, but can you say that or share the machine specs of these things?
So you have six different nodes. Every node has a quad-core CPU, ARM CPU right now. 2 gigs of memory, DDR3, and 1 terabyte hard disk, SATA 2 or 3, I think. I have to check.
3.
3? Yeah, SATA 3, okay. So those things combined, and there was a gigabit switch inside, so we'll have gigabit networking. The thing is, the components and boards that we're using right now, they're limited to 418 megabytes a second. But that's through the CPU design. IMX6 CPU design, direct memory access. But nevertheless, this is going to change. 64-bit ARM CPUs are coming, and they're coming fast, but not to us, apparently. So we just have to wait for them to come available, and once they come available, we can finally build these ARM hexes with 8, 16, or even more memory, which would be pretty neat.
And maybe also to say we're working on the prototypes, the Intel NUC versions, and they have three different versions of these motherboards available, and they range from a Celeron over an i3 up to an i5. These are dual core CPU, and they go up to from 8 to 16 gigabytes of memory, so they're more high power, they consume more power, of course. And we're talking to the guys in Kortrijk of Sizing Server Labs. We'll actually do benchmarks for Silicon Valley, and we're going to try to figure out how the various CPU levels stack up to each other on the level of performance. So that's something we're going to arrange during a couple of these and a few months and see what happens on the different ARM versions against the Celerons, the i3s, and the i5s. So it's going to be very interesting.
Yeah, I'm over here. The thing 64-bit is really hard to get in embedded world. Maybe another thing to note, the baddest thing that we built with the Intel version is an i5 with 16 gigs of memory and 500 gigs SSD drives. It's a guy with a lot of money. But yeah, it was performing really well. really.
What was the price tag for that one?
Okay, we don't well. We do want to know.
It's around that specific version was around 6,000 euros, something like that. It was really, really expensive. Maybe even too expensive for the things that he wanted to do with it, because from big data, well, he wanted to use big data technologies like Cloudera on top of it. And there, in my opinion, he could have used the larger disk space instead of the faster disks. So, but that's my opinion.
Yeah, my question was just, can you also, because you have shown it as separate instances, all those three, can you also combine them and have it on the same user interface and install Elasticsearch on 64 nodes if you have?
That's the idea, indeed.
Okay.
But that's something that we're working on right now. That's the reason why we built Surf in, just to make it easy to link all these things together. Obviously, everything is a DNS problem. And that means that it's very difficult to actually get the networking right. Especially if you have several different networks trying to work together, it's mayhem, really. So, but we're working on it. We're also working on Ubuntu Core. I don't know if there are any Ubuntu followers here, but we're trying to build it in, just to make it easier to deploy patches and stuff like that. So those are things that we're actually working on right now. Well, if we're not here.
Next question. Yeah.
I'm sure that you heard about the C2Boards project from online.net, which I think is near you all. But what I think really interesting in your project, besides the education that I like daily, it's indeed a production environment that you don't want to share the data. I'm thinking about banking companies and all that stuff that's cost a lot on this location to have a server which is all local storage, blah blah. So isn't that your next step to say, okay, maybe we can do something in production because we are near to that, basically up to a power supply and
that's something we're looking into, because we did a simulation on what with the heat that's being produced by these boards, what it would mean if we would fill a whole rack, a 42 unit rack, with these boards, and you would get up to 2.8 petabytes in one rack and like 600 nodes, and you would still consume less power than the actual rack if you would fill it with Intel solutions. So yeah, we're looking into it. The thing is, there will be a point when it becomes more easier, more cheaper to use virtual instances on the web, AWS for example. And yeah, there is some future for the cloud, we think, as well. So the software part is especially something that we're looking into. It's very difficult, even especially in distributed environments, to have application lifecycle management, where you take an application, you write it on one platform, take it to the other one, and it has to perform the same way. That's very difficult if you are talking about a lot of machines trying to do the same thing. So yeah, we're all looking into that, just making things easier. We're very easily frustrated, and we always try to find the solution for our frustrations. That's those things.
More questions? I saw more hands going up earlier on, but yeah, in the back of the room, go ahead. Yeah, maybe pass the mic on.
I need to find a way to help out my computer linguist, and she's doing some machine learning and so on. Would a Hex be a way to try to help her parallelize the algorithms and get faster solutions, or should I directly try to go to AWS or something like that?
I basically know what you're working on, so
yeah.
That makes it quite easy to answer, because yes, indeed, it would help you, especially in your case, where you're still prototyping and trying things out. It will allow you to see what it actually means if everything is working together, and especially what means if not everything is working together. Also to get a feel on what it would mean to do complex deployments and stuff like that. So. Yeah, I do think that it could be an added or give you an advantage. But of course, skepticism. there are always people saying that, yeah, you could probably use other things. You can buy your own cluster if you have a very forgiving wife. but it's totally up to you. I mean, I think that you can that can help you, but again, it's all up to you. And if you want help, reach out. I mean, that's why we're here.
Yeah, so you mentioned the tryout and everything goes wrong and so on. So I was wondering, is there an easy way to make some kind of snapshot of the wall X and then restore it? Like, I would like to just go to a stage, say, no, I'm going to try something very weird, let's see what's happened, and then be able to roll back.
One of the things that well, at least I have been thinking about, but we have had some discussions in the past, was a way to prototype on a hex and then to be able to save it as a tint. So then you will actually have your reproducible stack.
Yeah, because in my case it's a combination between the software and the data, so I need both of them.
Can you create the two tints? You have a data tint and you have the stack tint. And the good thing is that you can actually, if you have two hexes, you have one and Ton has one, you can actually transfer the tints from one hex to another, or combine the hexes together and do more. The thing is, if you do things like hackathons, where you spend a lot of time setting everything up, that could be very, very helpful to have something ready and just ship it through.
One last question.
Yeah. Well, it's not, might not become the last one, but we'll.
I will not play the devil lawyer. And I'm wondering, because I'm from the embedded electronics development, so I'm seeing that they are more dev board based. Okay, this is another small dev board based. How long did you try this hardware? I mean, in production. Prototyping, production, I would say. Because, for example, if we say, okay, we need a big cluster to do our try and blah, we go to AWS, for example, okay, we know that we can reserve a cluster for 1 year, it will cost that much, and this cluster will work for 1 year. So that's the idea, okay? It's definitely interesting to come to your solution, decide if you go to really big clusters, but if these clusters can run 24/7 during 1 year,
well, they have been running for a very long time at our place, and it hasn't burned down. no, they are, well, that's the thing, we need to test as much as possible, and yeah, we invite people to test it and try things out. And try
still in beta, for example?
We sell these as being prototypes.
Okay.
So they're not certified. Mm-hmm. They're not certified products yet. And the main reason for that is that again, we want to keep it as lean as possible. If we want to produce this, we would need a budget of like 500,000 euro to actually just have the first batch of 500 units ready. And that's a small step that we actually can do. So we are talking to Taiwan and to all the other ones. And the moment that you start talking with them, for example, the guys from the network chips. So we needed a gigabit network chip. And it was like, and how many millions are you going to order? Zero point zero zero zero. So it's right now we just build them on request. So people ask us, I want to have a hex, I want to try playing with it and experimenting with it. They send us a message, or they go to the website, order there, and we start building it. We ask them which color they like, which everything we need to know to actually start manufacturing them, and then we fire up our 3D printers. So this is how we're doing it right now, but this is not something that you can scale to 1,000 units a month. But we have the plans. The moment that should happen, let's hope that that's really soon, then we have the plans on how we can actually move forward. But it's not an easy thing to do.
Just to another aspect, you said it's a development board. Well, it's not a development board, it's an industrial board. These guys manufacture these things to be embedded in industrial and medical and military devices. So they are manufactured actually for low mean time between.
Yeah, sure, you don't leave it open to the desk like this in a military environment.
It's a harsher environment than on your desk, so. And they have very low return rates on the effective ones. So actually is a good motherboard in there. Intel's, I'm not so sure, but these works pretty well.
I can step in. I followed this project closely, and 2 years ago I saw the first ones batch, and some of those are still around, so they've been running for 2 years. And I'm not even traveling, like they got this through airport security. Yeah? Just imagine, like, hey, I have this thing with wires sticking out. I can't really say what's in there, it's a prototype.
Had a guy was filler.
So you can't go to USA anymore now.
Yeah, sometimes. They had more problem with my deodorant than they had with the hex.
That's a great ad, isn't it? You can ship this, it's easier than your deodorant.
But you can take it, it's really forgiving kind of thing. You can really harass it in every single way that you can imagine. The thing is, when we do 3D printing, it gets quite hot in the room that we do the 3D printing. We even put one there to see what actually happens when you go to high temperatures and stuff like that. A lot of people have asked us why it is a hexagon shape, because we will lose a lot of room basically that we could fill up with processing boards. It's basically a chimney. Cold air is being pulled in from the bottom and hot air is coming out from the top. That's being done on purpose. So by doing those things, we wanted to build something that doesn't make noise when you put it on your desk. It has to be very, very quiet. And to be honest, we have some kind of a cover to put over it. But it's very expensive. It's a metal cover. It's 300 euros or something for the cover alone. And most people, even if we suggest a cover, they say, nah, I'm a geek. I don't want to put this on my desk. So yeah, obviously the spider is one that we created yesterday, especially for this event. But it's going to be used for crawling and other stuff.
Can we motorize a spider?
Sorry?
Can we motorize a spider?
The thing about it, that it gives like movements.
Yeah, you said you're a geek, so definitely you have to think about this.
we have looked into it. We have someone who is doing our sales, and he gave some presentations, and he is really obsessed with the idea of putting a drone on top, for having it flying around. Well, I told him it was... He's not a tech guy. He doesn't know what's actually involved in doing something like that. But the thing that we tried to prove was that you can basically ask us anything, and we can build the maddest things. That's the beauty of 3D printing. And again, 3D printing for a prototyping stage and a first stage to your first batch in hardware development is basically a pretty good way of doing it. It allows you to start lean in hardware, and that's very difficult because of the large budgets.
You're exposing your emails now, so people see which opportunities you're missing.
There are opportunities for me, challenges.
More questions? No. It's actually. Dan doesn't know this, but while this was happening in the background, Shay has the co-founder of Elasticsearch has confirmed that they're looking into this. So something might happen here. So you've done a good sales pitch. So many thanks. And don't forget, after the meetup, we're going to go to the building next door. And those of you who like got very interested in this hardware, want to play around with it by deploying your own clusters and tins on there, just follow Dan. And Niels, and you can do the hands-on stuff that you're looking forward to.
Or if you want to discuss any further, or have ideas of anything, any feedback is welcome, as long as you don't kick or shout or.
Good. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. Where did the mic go?
So this is maybe a quick word too, that Elasticsearch is even helping us with Meetup, so they chip in, because we of course have to rent rooms and it needs to get clean and there's security and stuff like that. So thank you very much for that part. And I have unique USB servers. I'm going to show the goodies, raise the quality of the questions for you.
So. These swags are tricky, by the way, because they qualify as children toys, and apparently in the US those are really tricky to ship, right? People are concerned that there's like cocaine in them that we're trying to ship and smuggle into the US.
You children should not eat the plastic, yeah? So let this be very clear, because for the American customers of Elasticsearch, there's a special manual. First have to get the USB stick out of there, throw away the plastic. And there's two parts, and you can swallow them. So be very careful not to do that. They go into a USB port, yeah. So
question number one, do they go down easily?
I think on the other side of
the OK, so go ahead. Right, maybe you want to tell a little bit about the history. When you got the idea, when you started talking about it.
Typically I just like to sprinkle it through when during discussions or something. So I'd love just to have questions. I hate like long monologues or something. Any questions?
There we go. Dan, go ahead. Yeah. And I'm gonna hand the mic, that way everyone can hear, and we have a live stream going on, so there's more people tuning in there.
Thank you. One thing you see quite often is that Elasticsearch is being used as some kind of time-based data store. The thing is that we're using it for a particular, we're using it in another project that we're doing, where we store time series data. And there's no such thing as trying to find the last value or something. Becomes very, very difficult. I'm probably not explaining it well. But when you have to run through the different facts, it becomes very different to find the last one. There is no such thing as give me the last version of a specific document. Although I didn't find it, to be honest.
Well, yeah, it's a good question. I'll separate it into two. So time-based data, I think, I was always very, very excited about this, you know, aspect of usage in the context of Elasticsearch. I think a lot of the features, at least, that were added even before we started the company, when I was like IRCing with Jordan and Rashid, and even afterwards after we started the company, were meant to try to encourage people to use time-based data. I personally love time-based data because a lot of times it means like things like immutability of data. The ability to treat data that is older differently compared to data that is newer, right? I mean, there's the concept of age of data that is important. And we try to encourage people to use that type of data. Specifically regarding your question around finding the last value, I mean, the last document is relatively simple because you can sort by it. So I'm not terribly sure.
Yeah, the thing is we use a very flat, you can see it as being events. So the moment that something comes in, a record comes in, for example, we will split it up into different documents. And every single fact in the record is basically a new document that we're using.
Okay.
So at the moment that you need to visualize something, you basically need to know which the last value was of all these facts. So you're basically doing some kind of a bulk query. And you need to find the last version for every single one.
Oh, okay, I see.
So that's when it becomes, well, for our, in our use case, it becomes a bit slower doing this. So I was just wondering if there was a better way of doing it.
No, I think that's a tricky one to do. I think in general, in time-based data, it's tricky to do this type of querying. Sorry?
It's a Lucene problem.
I never blame Lucene. As far as I'm concerned, Lucene and Elasticsearch are in the same boat. But it's tricky to do that, by the way. I can't think of a way to doing it without heavy aggregations that will make it slower. But if that's a common use case, I'd love to like talk to you about on issues or whatever to try to see whether we can make it faster.
Would be interesting. Yeah.
Cool.
Thank you.
Brown elk.
Okay, so first USB stick flies through the air. Whoa, and he catches him, so he gets to keep it. Very well done, Dan. So,
Next. Send a USB stick to a guy that just had like a whole hexagon on.
It's true. How many ports do we get with that? Six USB ports, so he can get five more. Ask questions quickly, or he's gonna take them all. Yeah, go ahead. Pass the mic on.
I have implemented Elasticsearch quite a lot of times already in different search situations, and I have been customizing it a lot. So I've replaced scoring analyzers, of course some river implementation and so on. These things are not always that really extended, documented. Mm. So sometimes I feel not really at ease when I'm doing those things. Am I hacking Elasticsearch, or am I using it in the right way?
I think you pretty much qualify to the hacking of Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch was built with a lot of pluggability in mind. Not necessarily even in the context of users being able to plug it, just it's nice to build it in a modular fashion. And we're using something called Juice, which is like a dependency injection.
Yes, I know.
So effectively, yes. It means like almost any place in Elasticsearch is hackable and injectable.
Yes.
I think that the way that we look at Elasticsearch is that we try to get like the 95 or 97% of the user base not having to hack Elasticsearch in order to add additional features. And then it leaves the 3% of the users that says, okay, I want to write a plugin. Yeah, exactly. That's why I said you're hacking.
Yeah.
But like those 3% of the users that want to like extend Elasticsearch, add custom analyzers and what have you. And to be honest, like this is it's a question of software development to a level, because you know you can try to document everything that you can, and you have to prioritize because you have like whatever resource that you have. And I don't know if you've been around with Elasticsearch for a long time, you know that our documentation kind of was not as good as it should be, and we're slowly improving there.
That was a long time ago. I started with Lucene, and that's why I know a lot on how to do things.
That's great. My hope is to, like, we always aspire to get to a point where you won't have to do that. Like, you won't have to write plugins to extend Elasticsearch. Like, those functionalities will be built into Elasticsearch. And that means that you can like rely on like built-in features that are there. You won't have to suffer or work through upgrades and what have you. And then there's this tension that happens within the project, I think, which is like we want to move the project forward, keep refactoring, cleaning up dead code, what have you, and all of those things. And there's those 3% hackers that says, I'm going to add my own analyzer and what have you. I think we've been pretty stable in certain aspects, like analyzers have, the way to add them is relatively nice and stable, but there's some esoteric use cases that people hacked Elasticsearch and we haven't kept backward compatibility there. It's like, when I'm thinking about it, it's like, I really want to document it because I want users to push us as a project to get us to implement, like, make Elasticsearch as a full-blown, like, supported platform. On the other hand, the ones that are hackers and know Lucene and know how to extend it, like, Uwe and yourself, for example, would have the capability to go in and say, it doesn't do what I have today, I'm going to go in and make it do what I want. So it's kind of a tension level. I hope that we'll get to a point where we'll like properly document those extension points, at least ones that we see users doing quite a bit when they're like in the 3% stuff aspect, like analyzers and things like that. So sorry for now that it's not like properly
documented. Well, until now everything went fine, so I'm not.
Cool.
I only had one or two breakups in the API.
Okay, cool.
More questions?
So when using Elasticsearch, I'm used to kind of all database approach maybe, and the document approach is nice, but at some point when you need to share with other developers, it's hard to make sure the structure is well known. So JSON is one way to document it, and I was looking for a way to map it into an object thing. So I dig out the Canvas project in which you had the OSM thing, and I was wondering, is there some kind of equivalent planned into Elasticsearch soon, because so far the only thing live I found was the Spring Data Elasticsearch.
Yeah, I mean that's a good question. So I personally like the work that I did before Elasticsearch in OSM, which like trying to get the Java domain model and map it to Lucene directly back then. The way that I view it now, and I hope that the tools would mature, I would hate to try to like rewrite OSM. That was a lot of work back then, and I would much prefer to focus the work that we would have done like in the Java layer integration in Elasticsearch itself. I would hope that the tools mature, and they might be mature enough in the Java land to allow you to map objects to JSON, and then from JSON you can map it to Elasticsearch. So, for example, Jackson has those capabilities. I agree that they don't have the mapping concept on them, so you can say like this field is an ID or something like that in terms of annotations, but it gets you to a certain point. There's the Hibernate, the Hibernate OGAM project that I think it's interesting as well. It might be an interesting integration point. But the way that we look at it is that because we support JSON or JSON-like structures, then I'd love to integrate with tools that just work nicely with JSON and extend them. I think the best example that I have is Ruby, where Carl, who does the Ruby integration, has built the integration into Rails and ActiveModel, where you feel like Elasticsearch is just an extension of ActiveModel. And that's great. Like, this is how I would love to have this integration. So, if OJM in Hibernate becomes successful, or Spring Data or something like that, then we will make an effort to integrate into it. It would be kind of a shame for us to try to build a whole new OSM, which is our way of trying to map Java domain models into Elasticsearch. I would much prefer to implement something into a common layer that tries to do that. For example, there's no real difference between Elasticsearch and MongoDB in terms of mapping objects to either Elasticsearch or MongoDB, right? Both of them are JSON objects. So if there was like a project that tried to encapsulate that, we'll integrate with that and utilize that.
Yeah, the thing is that JSON is another schema itself, so mm-hmm. we lack of this, and then you have Jackson inside Elasticsearch at some point too, and you have Lucene, so it does make sense to me to have some kind of binding at some level.
Yeah, I mean, the fact that Elasticsearch uses Jackson is an implementation detail. You should not worry about it. Obviously, we will probably never change Jackson. I mean, I love Jackson. But the reason why, for example, it's even shaded is because that's an implementation detail. Like, you should choose whatever you want to do in your application. You should choose whatever JSON library you want to do, how you want to convert it, what have you. And again, like, taking the Java solution and applying, for example, to Ruby, I would not want to build an Elasticsearch active model, right? I mean, this would be a shame. Like, I don't want to go and try to explain to many, many different users how to use Elasticsearch Active Model. I would much prefer to utilize the fact that users know how to use Active Model and integrate with that. I think in Java it's kind of tricky because nothing really has breached became an active model to Elasticsearch. I know Hibernate OGM tries to be one. There's Spring Data, there's a few of those. I just hope that one will become more prevalent, and then we'll just have to integrate with that, and that's it. The cost of like Compass has cost me a lot of sleepless nights in trying to integrate it. I don't know if you like, I remember like trying to wrangle like 20 different, like, oh, it integrates with Hibernate and it does its own object mapping and reflection, and how does it do like 20 tons of different stuff. Like, this costs us a lot of time just trying to maintain it. I try to focus our efforts into Elasticsearch itself, and then find another project that tries to do it and just integrate with that.
Questions here?
Oh no.
It's just an easy question.
Okay.
Maybe explain
this
who
is
you
like
are.
A test.
Because he's wearing a t-shirt that says Lucene, so you can expect this to be an advanced question.
It's not a Lucene question.
I feel like
question.
People are going, like, what happens when you read your token stream on thread locals and you don't read?
No, nothing about that. It's just a question going in the direction of his question he had. So about the integration, is something people are waiting for a long time, and maybe it comes at some point. Is there something planned that you can have something like a Maven package with only the transport client and not all the other stuff around? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you have something that you can plug in
Elasticsearch from the Java world, but you don't need to hook in and get everything like Lucene.
That's a good question.
I think there were projects.
Yeah. So if I can like more qualify the question, Elasticsearch has support for something like called transport client, which you can like connect to Elasticsearch through just TCP and that's it. The thing is that it uses, you know, the whole node level serialization aspects and what have you. And that ends up like causing the Elasticsearch dependency itself, which is rather big. And today it also causes like a Lucene dependency as well. And this is also like an interesting tension. And I lived through it in Compass, right? I mean, in Compass, for example, I tried to create this resource abstraction on top of a document and a resource manager, what have you, on top of Lucene, and tried to create like a common API on top of Lucene. It was painful, like, you know, because every time you had to change it and what happened and when something changes, and can you really create an abstraction, like a common abstraction on top of Lucene? And also, trying to re-implement abstractions on top of like things like ByteRef and Lucene and what have you. If you just want to like, if you do highlighting, and you just want to return the results of the highlighting of Lucene, why not just return the highlighter object of Lucene itself, right? So in order to, for example, say the Java client does not require anything from Lucene, we would have to write those abstractions ourselves. And then it gets into a question of whether it's worth our time to try to build all of those abstractions, which effectively means duplicating the code of what Lucene does, just to make sure that there's a lightweight, like Java library that talks to Lucene. That talks to Elasticsearch. And part of it, to be completely honest, is the pain point of Java itself as a language, because, you know, Elasticsearch has a RESTful API. Writing even a very, very simple client on top of Elasticsearch in Ruby is like super easy. Writing it in Java is super painful. On the other hand, there's like if you're developing in Scala, there's a client in Scala that just talks to Elasticsearch over the HTTP API. There's a client in Clojure that talks to Elasticsearch over the HTTP API. So those are like languages that are more, have the notion of being able to be like more dynamic, so they can work nicely with like map of maps of maps of maps and what have you. So it's like a trade-off, right? I mean, and it goes back to my point to you. It's like, are we gonna spend time as an engineering group and as a community in just trying to build those abstractions on top of Lucene, or just they saying, like, this is an exceptional use case. Okay, so you're getting like a 7 megabytes jar instead of a potential 2 megabytes jar, which would be much more lightweight. But on the other hand, like, we don't have to maintain all of these abstractions and what have you. I would say that I tried to maintain some of those abstractions. There were like, during a long period of time, you could run the transport client without the Lucene jars. And then, like, Simon came in and said, I'm done with it. Like, all of those abstractions are worthless. And I agree with them to a degree, right? I mean, it's like, why do we need to create an highlighter abstraction on top of a Lucene highlighter abstraction just for the sake that there is an abstraction for it, right? And to be honest, like, most of the ones that ask, I don't know if that's what you're asking me, most of the ones that ask us for a lighter jar file were the people that were trying to deploy, like, Hadoop jobs. And then Hadoop had this, like, crazy, like, how to ship the jars and upload them to HDFS, and that would take like ages and what have you, using EMRs. And I think that case, I think we solved by building our own Hadoop integration, which is super lightweight. So I stopped hearing that lately. Maybe it's a long answer, but I hope it makes sense.
You could use more Groovy, but that's already part of the case. I have another question, because when
Groovy
we...
Groovy is interesting in terms of, you know, where it's going to end, but yeah.
You could help.
We do?
The thing is, when we started to use Elasticsearch, it was kind of a side product when you need to fast search or facets. And the question was, at that point, can it be a data store itself?
And do you see the rise of people using it on a main data store and without anything else right now, or is it still kind of a byproduct?
Yeah, that's a good question. Like whether Elasticsearch can be used as a data store or not. So I'll tell you, I think it's mainly qualifies about the data that you have. I would say that Elasticsearch is not mature enough to be like a Postgres level or an Oracle level data store in terms of its even just its maturity. I'm not even talking about features. So it really depends on your data. People are using Elasticsearch today as the main data store, but for example, these are for things like logs and what have you, and this is like the worst thing that happened, then they're okay with losing like a day worth of data or something along those lines. Whether you should store your financial records in a bank in Elasticsearch, I would probably say not yet. In terms of where how we treat it, in terms like in the development of Elasticsearch itself, we treat Elasticsearch as a main data store. Even though we say, don't use it for financial records in a bank, like if there's a bug in Elasticsearch that means that you lose data, like everybody are all over it, whether it's in Elasticsearch or Lucene, like we try to make sure that both Lucene and Elasticsearch are at a level that they can be used as the main data store. Now, whether you're going to use them as a main data store or not matters less to me, by the way, because sometimes even just the pain of re-indexing is just horrible enough that we should not lose data, right? Even if you don't use this as a main data store. So there's a lot of efforts that goes into it. I think that a big part of it is also just a matter of maturity, right? I mean, you probably wouldn't use like MySQL 2.0 as your main data store. So it's just a matter of just maturing as a project and seeing everything out there that happens to get to that point where we feel more comfortable about it.
Did we deserve an animal?
Everybody deserves
an animal, but you for your kind questions.
I think he has like 20 of those by now.
Yeah.
It's wasted.
You're gonna be traded in a few years, you know? I know that marketing is in the room. Oh, the people. Oh, yeah, okay, we're gonna throw a new part. There we go. Good catch. So, more questions. There's more swag, so go ahead.
Logstash and Kibana, by the way. I know a bit about those as well.
Everybody, huh? One in the back. Maybe if you put the mic, make the mic travel to the back.
So, are there, by the way, any beginners in the room? I've got a question. What are, in your opinion, the biggest pitfalls that people run into if they just grab Elasticsearch and start running it and start working with that?
Mm-hmm. Question, pitfalls. I think that once the cluster grows, not using dedicated masternode is probably one of the biggest ones that I've seen. Elasticsearch starts to be very simple, and as you grow the cluster, that's great. And you start with one, go to two, go to three, go to four, and then like at six or seven, I would say use dedicated masternodes. But like human nature goes like, why do I need to make that big change? Maybe I can hold it off, and I'll just add another node, and I'll just add another node. But eventually, I think like cluster grows, just need to have dedicated masternodes. I think the other one, which to be honest, I think Elasticsearch itself is to blame, is not upgrading. So there's always better, resiliency, bug fixes, what have you, as the cluster grows. I think we have download stats, and there's still like 1,000 users every day that download 0.90. It's like, I always look at those stats and I go like, can I contact them and beg for them to upgrade to a new version? And to be honest, like we just had like a long discussion about it, but I think that Elasticsearch can do a better job in terms of allowing users to upgrade more easily. This is one of the biggest features that we're trying to aim for like the next major version of Elasticsearch 2.0, which is like if you do a rolling restart of Elasticsearch, it will be much more lightweight. So our hope is that you would do a rolling restart of Elasticsearch and like within 5 minutes, you'll be on a new version, everything will be green, or relocation, or recoveries, or something like that. That's a big project. We need to change a bit the recovery algorithms that we have. But, it's like I would love users to build on newer versions, but on the other hand, I can't blame them of not being in on a new version because the upgrade and the rolling upgrade is just too painful today. It's like it's a process. It takes time until the cluster ends up being with green. I think once we make that simpler, I would hope that we solve that problem. So I would say like those are the two main pitfalls that we have in Elasticsearch.
Thank you.
Cheers.
If you pass the mic to in the front, there's a question up front here. It's traveling.
Could you talk a bit about service discovery? When I start looking at Elasticsearch on the solar and things, I went through Zookeeper. ATCD, but start to be quite established, well-known service discovery. Mm-hmm. What about Zen? It's start to be. Is it a custom technology that you have built, or and why you have a reason why you choose this one?
Sure. So the question is like Zen versus things like ETCD or Zookeeper or something like that. I think the first thing that a lot of people miss is that. There's using Zookeeper or ETCD or whatever, or Paxospace or the Zookeeper one for things like master election, and there's one around data replication. So those are like two completely different aspects, right? You can use Zookeeper or ETCD in order to do service discovery and master election, and you can use it in order to build a Paxospace type data replication type. So you move all your data, like all the indexing operations goes to Zookeeper in order to make sure that you don't lose data or what have you through the Zookeeper protocol. The master election one is much simpler. And that's what most systems use Zookeeper or ETCD for. So they use it mostly for master election. Now, the aim of Zen was to try to simplify that process. I've been around for a lot of years, and I don't know if you know, but the first version of Elasticsearch 0.4 actually used J groups, which I'll hold my opinions about the quality of it, but it tried to use like a formal way of like a better library that I won't have to build myself in order to try to do master election, at least master election. And it proved to be a huge failure. And my learning from that was that one of the reasons is that when I tried to help users, they had to manage two different systems. They had to manage how does J groups, like binds to ports, experience GC, tons of different stuff. And then there was Elasticsearch. My realization out of that was that actually just the mere fact that you need to manage two different systems caused a much higher percentage of users to fail compared to anything else. Like whether the algorithm is correct or not, whether split brain happens or can happen or what have you, just the mere fact that you had to manage two different systems, I just saw on the mailing list and trying to help users on IRC, that was causing the systems to fail much more rapidly and just causing data loss and what have you. So at least back then, and remember, like back then, Zookeeper was like in its infancy. I'm talking like 4.5 years ago. I said, okay, I'll try to start to build my own, like very simple, but using Elasticsearch own like networking protocol. So for example, if you send a search request and it results in a network timeout, it would actually affect the fact of whether the node is reachable or not. When you send an indexing request, and that indexing request fails. Actually probably fail that chart if it's a replica. Those type of like tight integration between the two. And I think that proved to be, first of all, it proved to be much more stable than whatever JGroups was. And I knew personally there were holes and there were like documented on issues. Probably that was one of the mistakes, was they were not like properly documented in other places, but they were properly documented on issues. And I still believe that the master election part is not like terribly complex to implement. Just a matter of just going in and making the effort and fixing it. which we did in 1.4. And I would love users to compare us in terms of, I think that the biggest problems today is that people say, okay, Xen is like has master election, and there's this whole replication aspect. And this is how most other systems like Solr or others use. They use Zookeeper for master election. And we have not been able to break Elasticsearch in terms of having a split run in 1.4. So if you manage to, I'd love to hear it because I want to fix it, first of all. But that's one part of the equation. And another one is replication, which is like a completely different mechanism that happens both in Elasticsearch and Solr and what have you in other systems. And some of them decide to use Zookeeper or etcd in order to do it. That's terribly slow. Raft is also, by the way, not very fast because it requires serializability of all the operations that happen. You can't have concurrent operations, which in Elasticsearch we kind of have to do in order to sustain high indexing rates. So it starts to become very interesting. But at least in 1.4, in Xen itself, I think that it's a much more resilient system by the fact that it uses the same infrastructure that Elasticsearch has, instead of having three different nodes that have their own networking stack, have their own even just configuration parameters, right? It's just more complex, and complexity tend to create more failures compared to other type of failures, which is more common. I hope that we did a good job in 1.4 in terms of master election. We still have a long way to go, but unrelated to master election, by the way. And we'll see how it goes. I think one of the biggest reasons why Elasticsearch is so successful is that it's easy to get started. And I would love us to push us into building a resilient system while still maintaining those characteristics of the system, instead of saying, okay, we'll go with Zookeeper and that's it. And now suddenly every user of Elasticsearch in the room needs to become a Zookeeper administrator, which is not very easy to do.
Insert yourself a little new friend.
We have three more items left and pizza's getting cold. So let's go for binary questions, right?
I was just wondering in terms of not queries, but index queries, like did you already hit the limit? Because I've been using Ibanez Search a while and there is a concurrency issue with Lucene. So is it a throughput limit or bottleneck that you can hit in terms of how many documents you can index by seconds or something like that?
Well, there is always one, but it's mainly depend, I think, on your hardware. I don't think that there's any inherent concurrency limits within whether it's Elasticsearch or Lucene itself. You know, there's some points of synchronization that happens during flushes or something like that, but I have not seen them being like the reason why you would run into problems. So I have seen systems that easily scale from 4 cores to 8 cores to 20 cores and utilize all of those cores, whether it's a single Lucene index or whether it's Elasticsearch itself. One of the interesting aspects that you have with Elasticsearch is that you can actually have multiple Lucene indexes. So even if Lucene itself hits any concurrency limit that it has, you can actually have multiple Lucene indexes by having multiple shards of the same index on a specific node. There is a question of just general bookkeeping that happened on an index, whether it's Lucene or not. So Lucene works in a way that it writes immutable segments, and it tries to maintain the same number of segments as it merges them together. So you can get into a point where it just starts to backflow on the number of segments that you have because you're indexing too fast. And then in Elasticsearch today and in Lucene 5 in the future, Lucene will start to slowly back pressure the indexing rate to make sure that the index itself in terms of number of segments is in a healthy state. But that depends on tons of factors, the size, the speed of your hard drive and CPU and what have you. So if you have enough SSDs and stuff like that, then you should not have a terrible problem. And obviously, when you start to get into Elasticsearch, you can always add more nodes. So I don't know if you're talking from experience, but I haven't seen.
The thing I had is multiple calls and writer lock issues with the scene, because at some points it took too much time to write, and then
Were you using Elasticsearch for it, or
no? It was Spring Elasticsearch and the scene behind, and it was not handled by Elasticsearch at that time. So that's probably one of the solutions we could have put.
You used it not through Elasticsearch.
No, it was Ibanez Search and the scene behind.
Yeah, the one thing that I can tell you from 15 years or 16 years of doing the scene.
Upgrade to Lucene 5.
well, that's what Uwe said. I would say something different, which is Lucene is really tough to properly use it. So you can easily trap yourself. You can easily like open an index writer every time or reopen an index reader instead of doing it in a thread or something. You can easily like trap yourself by the simplicity of the APIs and just implement a system that is inefficient. And that's most of the times that's what kills like pure Lucene applications. They just don't use Lucene efficiently.
Okay.
This more is questions. My plug to use Elasticsearch.
Okay. You wanted some Kibana questions? Nobody asked. I'm a big fan of Kibana 4, so thanks to you and everyone involved in this for the great work. So the kind of mandatory question, is there any time plan when we can expect a stable version?
Yeah, I hope that RC happens in a week or two. GA, we hope in a month or two, the GA version of Kibana 4. I love Kibana 4, by the way. I can go on a tangent now with Kibana 4, but I think that it's like you can see the progression that Kibana did. Kibana 3 was only Rashid. Kibana 4 just came back from Phoenix 2 weeks ago. We have an amazing team there, just fully focused on building Kibana 4. I'm super excited about what we're doing there. Also, I'm super excited about, I don't know if people know, it's a full rewrite of Kibana. And aside from the fact that it has like a whole different way of integrating with the system and building your own visualization and putting it on dashboards or stuff like that, I'm super excited about the future path of Kibana 4, which is like more having like pluggability, the ability for you to plug your own visualization, the ability for you to plug your own, logic into Kibana itself. Kibana, one of the funny things that happened, Kibana 1 and 2 started with a backend, right? PHP 1, I don't remember who Ruby mentioned that. Like PHP 1, you did. PHP 1, then Ruby. Then I talked to Rashid and said, let's do it all in the browser. That's the future. So Kibana 3 was like all in the browser, and then we realized that, oh man, you can't do like CSV export in the browser because it sucks. and then Kibana 4 actually has now a backend, which is, I think the pull request just came in. It's Node.js based, which is, obviously the Kibana team is really happy because they're excellent JavaScript developers. And we hope to create like pluggability both on the UI layer and also on the backend layer. So you can just like plug in your own app or your own visualization and what have you, and just extend Kibana to your own needs. I think that was one of the more difficult things to do in Kibana 3, which we hope that we solve in Kibana 4.
Can you go PHP, Ruby, JavaScript?
Pure JavaScript, but now Node.js, which is like JavaScript in the server.
So the next one is going to be Go?
Yeah. I hold my opinions about Go to beers and pizza.
You can choose.
Yeah, okay.
One more question. Everybody wants to go and have pizzas? Yeah, so just a practical announcement about that. So we have been coming from 3 different pizza deliveries. There's about a dozen out there now. There's 2 more deliveries arriving. So if you think there's not enough, there's 30 more pizzas arriving in a few minutes. We'll put a little box because this is partly being paid for by sponsoring. It would be nice for those that have a budget to pay €5 for a drink. Seems that to keep in a little box. Much appreciated. And watch out, you've been drinking a Duvel beer, did a great presentation after drinking that. We have to know that some of these Belgian beers are stronger than what you might be used to. So it's this
Duvel. I can attest to that.
You can attest. Maybe you did a great presentation in Q&A, but you were, without knowing it, you picked a strong one. But if it says Trappist,
means you shouldn't have five.
Unless you're four.
Or if you want to turn into an alcoholic or show your colleagues how you can. Big, big thanks to everybody for showing up. Time to